It's the last time that I spoke, and we were in Galatians was December 8th, I believe. So it's been 7+ months since we were here. So I'll try and summarize kind of where we've been, or at least in the present chapter that we'll be looking at, just to kind of help refresh our memories of the context and what's going on a little bit. You know, the COVID thing really threw a wrench in everything. The study that we're going to do this week, I was working on back in December, right, prepping it for the next time I'd be up here. And obviously we've put some more work into it since then. But, you know, to go back and pull those notes and be like, oh, yeah, like, we've already done, you know, we've already kind of had this going. And what's interesting is that now that we're doing the study now, there's parts of this that are coinciding with what I'm going through with the high schoolers in the Sunday school meeting currently. So it's just kind of interesting how those things work out. So Galatians chapter 2, we'll start in verse 1 and read down a little bit just to kind of remind ourselves where we are. Chapter 2, verse 1, then 14 years after, and that's 14 years after he first goes to Jerusalem and see some of the brethren there, and then goes from there into Syria and Cilicia, chapter 1, verse 21. Then 14 years after, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and took Titus with me also, and I went up by revelation and communicated unto them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain. But neither Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was compelled to be circumcised, and that because of false brethren unawares brought in, who came in privately to spy out our liberty which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage, to whom we gave place by subjection, no, not for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. But of these who seem to be somewhat, whatsoever they were, it maketh no matter to me, God accepteth no man's person. For they who seemed to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me, but contrariwise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter, for he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go to the heathen and the end of the circumcision. Let's pray real quick. Dear Lord, we thank you for this time of study. We thank you for your word, Lord, and we pray that this time would be profitable and too edifying, Lord. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, and love. In Jesus' name, amen. So just to kind of catch us up, right, as we're studying here in chapter 2, this is going to coincide with the events of Acts chapter 15. Paul, Barnabas, and Titus, they've gone down to the leadership of the kingdom church there in Jerusalem to have a meeting regarding the law's place, or lack thereof, in the life of the body of Christ believer, right, in the dispensation of grace. And after some, you know, I guess some contentious debate, right, and you can see that if you look at Acts chapter 15, after some, you know, somewhat contentious debate, mostly among what Paul refers to here as false brethren unawares, these are what I believe are kingdom saints that are just coming in, and they've got some misunderstanding themselves about what God's doing, right, in the current dispensation. After some debate amongst that group, right, there's an agreement come to, right, where Paul and Barnabas and Titus, they are going to, you know, completely sever their ministry from the ministry of the 12, where, you know, the leadership there recognizes that the dispensation of grace is started, that there has been a dispensational change, that God is doing something different with Paul. They recognize his gospel. They recognize the distinctiveness of his ministry, and they extend to him the right hand of fellowship. We'll get down there in a couple weeks, where they say, okay, you're going to go to the heathen, in this passage, the uncircumcision, the Gentiles, and you'll conduct the ministry there, the ministry of the grace of God, and we'll go to the circumcision. We're going to continue our ministry with the circumcision church, with the kingdom church. So their ministries there are completely severed, and there's some letters that go back and forth in Acts chapter 15 that we've looked at previously in some of the former studies. So they've got this ministry now, it's been completely severed from one another. And Paul says here in the last time we studied, he says there in verse 7, but contrarywise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, and that's what we looked at last week, was the gospel of the uncircumcision. And trying not to, you know, reteach that message, because we've already taught it and we want to move on now that we have the opportunity. A quick understanding of that would be the idea of the gospel of Christ, how that gospel is being preached to the world under this time of worldwide reconciliation to God, where the Gentiles as well as the Jews have access by faith, by grace through faith, right, to salvation, where man can be justified regardless of his nationality, ethnicity, whatever, right? There is no favored status anymore like there was in time past, where the Jew had, you know, the where they were God's chosen people, where Israel were that peculiar people set aside, and God dealt specifically with them. We'll look at the passage earlier, but Romans chapter 3, verse 1, what advantage then hath the Jew? Well, in time past, he did have an advantage, right? And in that passage, the advantage is that he had God's word. They were God's chosen people, and that word set them aside. The fact that they had God's word, that they had his art, that they had his ordinances and his statutes and his judgments, made them a peculiar people. It made them a people apart. It made them a people separate from the rest of the world. So Paul now, his message is one of grace. Christ came and he offered himself as a propitiation. You know what? Get two passages. Romans chapter 1, verse 16, and Romans chapter 1, verse 16. I think this is the best way to define the gospel of Christ. Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein, in the gospel of Christ, is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." So the gospel of Christ is going to reveal, right, put on display, make known God's righteousness in the dispensation of grace, how we can obtain God's righteousness in the current dispensation. We find those details in the gospel of Christ. How are we going to obtain righteousness with God? How can man be righteous with God? Okay? The gospel of Christ in the current dispensation gives us those details. If you flip over to chapter 3, he says in verse 21, "But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested." Now he's going to start to tell us, okay, here's how the righteousness of God is going to be manifested. It's manifested apart from the law. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. What's the gospel of Christ? You are a sinner. Christ came and offered himself as a propitiation, and God will justify you through faith in what Christ accomplished. That's the gospel of Christ. Okay? He says here in verse 21, this is how God's righteousness is made manifest. Here's how it's declared. Here's how it's made known. Christ came and offered himself as a propitiation. Chapter 1, verse 16, 17 calls that the gospel of Christ. Okay? That's how God's righteousness is made known, in that gospel, in what Christ did for us. Okay? That's the gospel of Christ. That compared, you know, combined with the idea that in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11, "Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye, you uncircumcision, were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye, you uncircumcision, who sometimes were far off, are made nigh by the blood of Christ." And that's really what reconciliation is, that idea of being brought nigh. And specifically in verse 14, "For he is our peace," the idea of being brought back together in peace. not just back together, right, so we're closer to God so that, you know, it's easier for him to whack us. It's the idea that we've been brought together in peace, the idea of, you know, a married couple that separates, right, for a time. If they come back together, it's called, we say they've been reconciled, right? They've been brought back together, hopefully in peace, because now the relationship has been mended, right? The idea is we've been brought back to God in peace. Now, reconciliation doesn't equal justification. It's not the same thing. It's just we've been brought nigh so that we have access, right? We're no longer like we were in verse 12, aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. We have a hope now. There is a hope offered to the Gentiles, specifically. It's for all men. It's not something that we have to, you know, go through Israel's program any longer or anything like that. We have a hope in Christ. The world has a hope in Christ. We can look to him. We can put our faith in him. Any man today can put, man, woman, child, whatever, can put their faith in Christ and be justified from all the things that are wrong with them. So he says, verse 14, for he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off and to them that were nigh. Okay? That, to me, that's the gospel of the uncircumcision, right? He's telling you in this passage, hey, you uncircumcision, you had no hope. Now you do in Christ, because he came and he's preaching peace to you through what he accomplished for you at Calvary. That's the gospel of the uncircumcision. Super small nutshell, right? And we could, you know, spend a lot of time developing that, but we're not going to. We've already done it, okay? I want to move on this week in Galatians chapter 2 to the next kind of clause there in that verse. Galatians chapter 2, verse 7, he says, but contrarywise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter. So the gospel of the circumcision. So if we have an idea of what the gospel of the uncircumcision is, right, in this passage, the next thing that is discussed is the gospel of the circumcision. And how are those two things different, right? Is this an issue of one gospel just be going to one group of people, right? So the idea in verse 9 there, and when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. Is it this separation of gospel of the uncircumcision and gospel of the circumcision just an issue of, hey, Paul's going to go and take the, you know, this message to the Gentiles, and Peter and the remaining members of the 12 and the leadership there in Jerusalem, and they're going to take it to Israel, but it's really the same message, right? Is that what's going on here, or is it something different? See, in verse 9 there, it says that he will go unto, right? So, I mean, if Paul wants to say something about him going to a people, he knows how to say that, okay? But when he says in verse 7 there, the gospel of the circumcision, this is not a gospel that it's not one gospel that's being taken to two different people. It's a gospel for this group over here and a different gospel for that group over there. So if the gospel of the uncircumcision is that Christ came and offered himself as a propitiation for our sin and we can by faith be justified through his completed work on Calvary, what's the gospel of the circumcision? How is it different? What does it entail? So I'll give you my thoughts. So if we've read Ephesians chapter 2, if you go back there, I want to kind of look at it from the other direction a little bit. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 again, he says, wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ. So if they were without Christ, who had them? Israel. Being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, okay? Strangers from the covenants of promise. So if the Gentiles were strangers from the covenants of promise, whose were they? Israel's. Having no hope. So the Gentiles didn't have any hope, but that means that Israel did. And without God in the world. The Gentiles were, but Israel was not. Okay? If we look at it from this side, right, the circumcision, okay, this, go to Romans chapter 9, is another passage that kind of discusses this idea. The Israel had status, and they had promise, and they had hope. Okay? They had access to God. They had his word. Romans chapter 9, verse 3, "For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brother and my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises, whose are the fathers, and of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God bless forever. Amen." Israel had some stuff in time past. They had things to hold on to. They had the word. They had the promises. They had the covenants. They had the coming Messiah. The Gentiles didn't have any of those things. Israel did. So how do those items, okay, which all sound like good things, covenants, promises, having Christ, he came, Christ came, in that passage, of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, right? The Messiah comes for them, okay? How are those good things related to the gospel of the circumcision, okay? So, I want to kind of use that passage there in Ephesians 2 as kind of a jumping off point, okay? They were, in verse 12, they were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Specifically, I want to look at those ideas, that idea of the covenants of promise and the hope, okay? And how those things are going to relate to the gospel of the circumcision and Israel's good news, okay? So the first thing, and this is something that hopefully most of us are pretty familiar with. If you come with me to Genesis chapter 12, God makes several covenants with the nation Israel in time past. And the first one here, right, is with the first patriarch of the nation, right, Abraham, the man that kind of starts the whole thing. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, he says, "Now the Lord said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." So we're going to look at the covenants a little bit, okay? The first of those covenants is the Abrahamic covenant, okay? And the initial promise there, and the one under which the rest of these things are essentially going to fall, is that promise of, "I will make of thee a great nation." We'll see how the other things relate to that later. But the idea of a great nation, okay? He's going to make a nation out of Abraham. He is going to form a people, beginning with Abraham, and a people that he later is going to call a peculiar people, right? A people that's separate, his people. Okay? So he promises them here a great nation, and then there are, obviously in that passage, there are a lot of different blessings that go along with that, okay? So the Abrahamic covenant. In that promise of a great nation, in order to have a nation, there are several things that you have to have, okay? The United States is, for instance, okay? In order for us to be a country, there are several pieces that have to be in place for us just to be a nation. Okay, anybody want to throw a couple things at me? I got an idea. If you're going to be a nation, what do you have? Government. Someone said order. What? Borders. Okay, borders. Anybody else? Culture. People, language, okay. So we're going to look at those things, okay? We've got borders or land, right? A territory, a defined territory. People, right? A government, some kind of culture or rule of law, okay? In order for you to be a nation. Pastor Jordan has several times recently discussed the issue of language and language's involvement in being a nation. And specifically, he was doing so in discussing the Tower of Babel and how God separated the people there at the Tower of Babel in order to, create nationalism, right, and separate the different people groups and, you know, and scatter them across the face of the earth like he had instructed them to do. The thing I'll say with language is a particular language, while it's important for a nation, and it's hard to have a nation where there's more than one official language anyways, okay? The issue with language is you can have multiple countries that all speak the same language, and it doesn't necessarily make one peculiar from another, okay? You can't have multiple countries that all occupy the same territory. You can't have multiple countries that all include the same set of people, okay? Or that are governed by the same government, okay? If it's its own sovereign nation, they have their own people, their own land, their own government, and their own set of laws or culture or society, right? So while language is important, I don't believe that language establishes a nation as peculiar, right? Just because, not because language is unimportant, but just because multiple countries, and you can see this, right? Just looking at the US and the UK, right? We're separate countries. We both speak really pretty close to the same language anyways, right? So the first one we have here is the Abrahamic covenant. If you flip the page, Genesis chapter 13, you look at verse 14. And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art, northward and southward and eastward and westward, for all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. Does God promise Abraham and his seed a particular territory? Yeah, he absolutely does. There's other passages that specifically define the territory for us, okay, where God sets the actual borders down to, you know, this is going to be your western border, this will be your eastern border, and, but he defines that land for them, and here he makes them that promise, I am going to give you this land, I'm going to give this land to you and your seed forever. He makes this covenant with them. A lot of times this is referred to as the Palestinian covenant, right? And it has to do with the land. They have a land. Okay, God promises them a land, right? A particular territory, defines their borders in other passages. The next verse, verse 16, and I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. I separate these two. Sometimes they get lumped together. I separate these two. I call this a seed covenant, right? Because God promises Abraham here a multiplied seed, right? Your seed will be as the dust of the earth, right? If a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed be numbered, right? The idea is it's an innumerable amount of people, right? You're going to be a multiplied seed. So you have land, you have people in this passage, okay? So obviously, anyone who's at all familiar with the covenants, right, can see where this is going, okay? The next thing we talked about is government, okay? There has to be some form of government. Anarchies don't work. Whatever the government is, okay, there needs to be some form of governmental structure. 2 Samuel chapter 7. Nathan the prophet shows up and he's talking to David, giving him some information from God, and he says in verse 12, and when thy days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commit iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the children of men, but my mercy shall not depart away from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away before thee. And thine house and thy kingdom shall be established forever. Thy throne shall be established forever. The throne is going to be established forever. The seat of government, all right? That governmental rule here in the Davidic covenant, okay, establishes that eternal government, that eternal throne, okay? how the nation is going to be governed. Okay? That seat of power is established here in the Davidic covenant. Okay? The next thing that was said, John mentioned culture. Okay? If you come with me to Exodus chapter 19, right? Culture, societal structure, right? You might say rule of law, okay? Whatever you want to put on that. The idea is, how are people going to act or behave within this nation? How are they going to relate to one another? How are they going to relate to those outside of the nation? How are they going to relate to their God? How are they going to relate to their government? All these different things, okay? We find that here in the Mosaic Covenant, right? The law. He says in Exodus 19, verse 3, "And Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, Thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagles' wings, and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Moses came and called for the elders of the people, and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. And the people answered together and said, All that the Lord has spoken we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord." Okay? This is the beginning of the Mosaic Covenant, right? I'm going to do this for you. We're going to make an agreement between me and you, Israel. Okay? We're going to establish a covenant between us. And if you keep my covenant, you'll be a peculiar treasure unto me above all the earth. And for all the earth is mine. So he establishes them over the next several chapters and the next few books. He establishes the law. He establishes the Mosaic Covenant, which is going to form for them their culture. I'm sorry, my writing is very poor. It's going to establish their culture. It's going to establish their societal structure. It's going to establish their law. So it gives them the law. And we see in these subsequent covenants, right, how God is going to ultimately fulfill that covenant up there. Okay? If God is going to make a great nation out of Abraham, and if he's going to make a great nation out of the children of Israel, there are some pieces that have to be put in place for that group to be a nation. They have to have a land, defined borders. They have to have people. They have to have some form of government. They have to have some kind of societal structure, some way to relate to one another and those outside. Okay? And he establishes those things for them in the covenants that he establishes with them subsequent to the Abrahamic covenant. Now, some of the other issues in the Abrahamic covenant, the issue of I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. I will bless them that bless thee, curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. Some of those blessings then are also associated with these covenants, specifically the Mosaic covenant. Okay? Leviticus chapter 26. Leviticus 26. Again, a familiar passage. He says in verse 3, If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then will I give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the fruits of the field shall yield their fruit, and your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time, and ye shall eat your bread to the full and dwell in your land safely, so on and so forth, down through verse 13. He gives them all of these various blessings that are associated in verse 3 with them walking in his statutes and keeping his commandments and doing them. If Israel is going to receive blessing, it's going to be in association with her adherence to the law. So how is God going to, what mechanism does he use in order to supply the blessings that are associated with the Abrahamic covenant? Adherence to the law. So, there's a bit of a problem with this setup. And it has nothing to do with God, and it has nothing to do with the covenants. The problem rests in man. It rests in people. Okay? Because Israel has no capacity to keep their end of that bargain. Okay? In Exodus 19, Moses makes this initial statement to them. Hey, God is going to establish this covenant with you. He's providing us with these laws. He's giving you some commandments. He says, if you do them, he'll bless you. They said, all right, we'll do everything he says. And then Moses goes up on the mountain. He's up there for 40 days, and he gets the details of the law there in Exodus chapter 20. He received the Ten Commandments and some of the issues associated with the righteousness of God. Chapters 21, 22, 23, it's issues related to kind of everyday life type stuff. And then chapter 24, 25 is more like ceremonial type laws, right? Moses is up there on the mountain getting all of these details. And while that happens, Israel is down at the base of the mountain, getting a little antsy, getting a little, where's Moses gone to? And after 40 days, they say, hey, he's been gone for a really long time. Maybe he died. We don't know what happened to him. Hey, Aaron, we need a God to worship. And Aaron makes them the golden calf. They don't make it 41 days before they've broken commandments 1 and 2. They can't even, they've got a horrible start, let alone, the hundreds and thousands of years after that, right? They don't get past commandments 1 and 2 after just a handful of days. So they have a problem. Problem's not with the law, right? Romans chapter 7, verse 12, wherefore the law is holy and the commandment holy and just and good. There's no problem with the law. There's no problem with God's word. There's no problem with God's covenant, with God's promise. The problem resides with man and our part in that. Specifically, not us, but Israel in time past. Okay? They couldn't fulfill their portion of the deal, their portion of the agreement, which they said they would. Which they, all that the Lord has said we will do, they fall short over and over and over again. And this passage in Leviticus chapter 26 gives us the details about what's going to happen then when they don't obey. And we're not going to read through it all, but verse, because it's a significant chunk here, but just verse 20 or verse 14 there, but if you will not hearken unto me and will not do all these commandments, and if you shall despise my statutes, or if your soul shall abhor my judgments, so that you will not do my commandments, but that you break my covenant, I also will do this unto you. I will appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning ague that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and you shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it, and I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and you shall flee when none pursueth you. And then that's just cycle number one. And then, hey, if that doesn't work, I'm going to punish you seven times more for your sins. If that doesn't work, seven times more. If that doesn't work, seven times more. If that doesn't work, I'm going to be really angry, right, and walk contrary to you in fury, and then you better really watch out. There in course number five. Israel fails over and over and over again repeatedly, right, to keep their end of that Mosaic covenant. Two sides to an agreement, right? Like a pro sports player, right? They make an agreement with the team. Hey, we'll pay you X, Y, or Z dollars because we think you're really good and we like you and we want you to continue to be on our team, one of our people. So we're going to give you all this money so that you keep doing good things for us. But then when that player stops doing good things, what does that team do? They cut him loose, right? And unless he's got guaranteed money in his contract, he loses out on any of the money, the blessings associated with that contract that he broke because he stopped playing well. Okay? Israel fails. Right? But if God is going to accomplish this promise, right, to make them a great nation and to bless them like he said he would, which, by the way, this is an unconditional covenant. Unconditional covenant, unconditional covenant, unconditional covenant, unconditional covenant. When God gives those promises to Abraham, David, and he doesn't put any conditions on it. There is no, hey, in order for me to give you this land or to multiply your seed, you must do X, Y, or Z. They're unconditional covenants. When he makes that promise to David in 2 Samuel chapter 7, there is no, hey, if you do this, I will establish your kingdom. He says, I will do it. Unconditional covenants. The Mosaic covenant, however, is different. He says in that passage in Leviticus 26, if you do this, then. if you don't do this, then. It's an if-then covenant. It's a conditional covenant. If this covenant is conditional, how is God going to use a conditional covenant in order to fulfill an unconditional one? Especially when this conditional covenant fails due to the participant's inability to keep their part of the bargain. He's got to fix something. He's got to fix what's wrong. Just like he's done and has done and will do over and over again, God fixes man's problem for us because we're incapable of doing it ourselves. Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah 31, verse 31, he says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them forth out of the land of Egypt." Stop there. He's making a direct connection between the new covenant and the Mosaic covenant, right? The covenant that he made with their fathers in the day that he took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt. He's making a direct connection with the Mosaic covenant and what Jeremiah 31 calls the new covenant. Keep reading verse 32. "Which my covenant they break, although I was an husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be their people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." He says, this covenant's not working. Why? Verse 32 there, right? "Which my covenant they break." Right? Israel broke it. So I need to establish a covenant with them that's not according to this covenant, that's not the same as that covenant. I need to do something different because that one didn't work because of their failure. So he says, I'm going to establish the new covenant. I'm going to give them a new covenant, something that's not the same as that Mosaic covenant, something that's different, something that's going to that will operate in a different way, that will, in this passage, cause them. Well, I'm sorry, in this passage, verse 33, "I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people." He's going to take his law and write it on their hearts. If you go to Ezekiel chapter 36, which is another passage discussing this promise, although it's not named here as it is in Jeremiah chapter 31. Ezekiel chapter 36, and look at verse 22. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 22. "Therefore say unto the house of Israel, Thus saith the Lord God, I do not this for your sakes, O house of Israel, but for mine holy name's sake, which ye have profaned among the heathen whither ye went. And I will sanctify my great name, which was profaned among the heathen, which ye have profaned in the midst of them. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, saith the Lord God, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries, and I will bring you into your land. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. And you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God." Not only is he going to put his law on their hearts, he's going to put his spirit in them and give them the ability to keep that law. Give them the ability to keep the statutes, to walk in the judgments, to do the commandments. If then, in the new covenant, they have the ability to keep the commandments and keep the statutes and keep the judgments, what then does that free up God to do? Frees him up to bless them, right? In accordance with the Mosaic covenant. Because now what are they doing? They're keeping the commandments. They're keeping the statutes. They're keeping the judgments. Right? Without this new covenant, which, again, unconditional covenant, there is no, if Israel does X, Y, or Z, I'm going to accomplish this. He just says, I'm going to do it. He makes this new covenant with them and says, hey, by the way, this is a lesson you should have learned, Israel. Galatians chapter 3, 24 says, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us under Christ that we might be justified by faith. Israel should have known just from a short time under the law that there was no way they were going to be able to keep it, that they needed to go to Christ, that they needed to go to God to be their Savior, to save them from themselves. But he's going to establish this new covenant with them and cause them to keep those commandments and statutes and judgments so that God then is able to provide them with the blessings associated with the Mosaic covenant. And once he's able to provide them with those statutes, those blessings associated with the Mosaic covenant, that will then enable God to complete that overarching promise, that overarching covenant that he made with Abraham back in Genesis chapter 12. So how does that relate to, how does all that relate to Israel's good news or the gospel of the circumcision, right? How does that, the gospel of the circumcision, or how is that a part of the gospel of the circumcision? Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, and look at verse 6. Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. It says that the scripture preaches the gospel to Abraham, saying, here's the content of what was preached to Abraham in the gospel, in thee shall all nations be blessed. Do you know what that phrase is taken from? It's the last phrase in the Abrahamic covenant, in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. To Abraham, what was the gospel? What was the gospel that he believes in verse 6 that justifies him, that's counted to him for righteousness? It's the Abrahamic covenant. That's the good news for Abraham and for the people that are going to come from him. Genesis chapter 17 provides the covenant of circumcision and says, hey, this covenant is going to identify the individual with the nation so that all of these blessings then can be passed to that individual because these blessings are associated with the nation, with the seed. Okay? All of these things are accomplished to make this nation, and he identifies that nation, right, and or the members of that nation through the covenant of circumcision. Okay. So how is this the gospel of the circumcision? Well, this is a gospel that's promised to the people who are called the circumcision, who partake in the covenant of circumcision. Okay. This is their good news, or at least part of it. Okay. Because when Peter and the 12 start preaching the gospel of the circumcision, right? And they take the gospel of the circumcision to the kingdom believers there or the members of Israel there in early Acts. Are they just going back and preaching the Abrahamic covenant? I mean, hadn't something else kind of major happened by that point? I mean, something big happens in the history of Israel's program between these covenants and the preaching of the 12, the ministry of the 12, right? Christ shows up. The Messiah shows up. Come with me to, let's start in Jeremiah chapter 7. Go to Jeremiah chapter 7. So, I said I wanted to use Ephesians as kind of a jumping off point, right? That the issue of the circumcision having the covenants, right? The covenants of promise and having hope and being with God in the world as opposed to the Gentiles who were strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Okay? So we've looked at the covenants. I want to look at the hope now. Because Israel, by the point that Christ shows up, by the time Messiah shows up, Israel has been languishing under the fifth course of judgment for something like 550 plus years. Okay? Where does that number come from? Well, they go into captivity, and they're in captivity for, anybody? Prophesied captivity is 70 years, right? Jeremiah, right? Daniel says that he understands by books from Jeremiah the prophet that the time of the captivity will be 70 years, okay? So then Daniel says in chapter 9, from the going forth of the commandment, you know what? We're in the Old Testament. Look at Daniel 9. Daniel chapter 9. He says in verse 24, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 80 days. A week here in this passage is 7 years, right? Not 7 days, 7 years. So if from the commandment to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild Jerusalem, if from that point you have 483 years, which is 69, 7 plus 62, 69 weeks, times 7, 483 years. If you have a period of 483 years, which happens after 70 years worth of captivity, you have 553 odd years. Okay. Now, you can possibly push the timing of the start of the fifth course of judgment earlier than when the captivity actually starts, right? Because there's some time where Nebuchadnezzar is besieging the city, and you can see some of the curses associated with the fifth course of judgment, like people eating their children, right, happening in Jerusalem before the captivity actually begins, right? So the fifth course of judgment doesn't necessarily start the moment they go off into captivity. It's slightly before that, but you've got somewhere in the neighborhood of, 553 to 500 and, some odd years. Okay? They've been languishing under the fifth course of judgment for that period of time when Christ finally shows up. It's a long time. Right? That's twice as long as our nation has been, in existence. Right? That's a long time to be languishing under exile, basically, right? Where you are no longer a country. You're kind of, many of them are back in the land, but they're not their own nation. They're not a country. They're just there being ruled by others and dominated by others during the times of the Gentiles. But they have a hope. Jeremiah chapter 7. There are many, many verses in the Old Testament related to Israel's hope. Many in the Psalms. I chose just one passage for sake of time. Jeremiah chapter 7. And we'll start reading in verse 7. Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 7. Then will I cause you to dwell in this place, in the land that I gave to your fathers forever and ever. Behold, you trust in lying words that cannot profit. You steal, murder, and commit adultery. Am I in the right? Yeah. And swear falsely, and burn incense unto Baal, and walk after other gods whom ye know not, and come and stand before me in this house which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered to all these abominations. In this house is this house which is called by my name become a den of robbers in your eyes? Behold, even I have seen it, saith the Lord. But go ye now unto my place which was in Shiloh, where I set my name at the first, and see what I did to it, for the wickedness of my people Israel. And now, because ye have done all these works, saith the Lord, and I spake unto you, rising up early and speaking to you. I feel like I am not in the right passage. I am not. This is not what I want. Seventeen seven. Sorry, that's where I want. I apologize. 17:7. I left the one part off my notes here. 17:7. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, in whose hope the Lord is, for he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. As the partridge sitteth on eggs and hatcheth them not, so he that getteth riches and not by right shall leave them in the midst of his days, and at the end, and at his end be a fool. O, a glorious high throne from the beginning is the place of our sanctuary. O Lord, the hope of Israel, all that forsake thee shall be ashamed, and they that depart from thee shall be written in the earth, because they have forsaken the Lord, the fountain of living waters. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved, for thou art my praise. Okay? Israel's looking to the Lord for their hope, for their salvation, for their healing. Israel needs to be saved. And here in Jeremiah, he recognizes that. And the Spirit writes that the Lord is the hope of Israel. Here, Jehovah, Christ, is the hope of Israel. He's their hope. He says there in verse 14, heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. The nation needs to be healed. Right? The things that are wrong with them need to be fixed. How is that going to accomplish? How is that going to be accomplished? Who is going to accomplish that? Is it something that they're going to be able to complete themselves? No, they're not going to be able to accomplish that themselves. They need to look to the Lord for that. They need to look to the Lord for that hope, to the Lord for that salvation, to the Lord for that healing. Which is why you get a passage like, you know, that passage here in Isaiah 53, right? About Christ. He says in verse 4, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before his shears is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Verses 4 through 9 give you the description of the physical suffering of Christ associated with his redemptive work, specifically in this passage, for Israel, and how he'll heal them with that. Verses 10 and 11 give you the inner man part of that sacrifice. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Christ takes on both a physical and inner man punishment here. He experiences both the first and the second death on the cross. He experiences the eternal wrath of God against sin, not just the physical anguish of a physical death, right? But the eternal anguish of God's undiluted wrath against sin. He experiences all that on the cross, specifically in this passage for Israel, so that he can heal them, so that he can be their Savior. Now, they didn't understand this passage about him. They didn't, even the 12, those that followed him, they didn't understand all these things about him. Peter, days before Christ goes to the cross, he says, hey, we're going to go to Jerusalem, and they're going to take me, and they're going to crucify me. And Peter says, not so, Lord. We're not going to let that happen. And he brings a sword into the garden to defend Christ from those who are going to try and take him. Peter doesn't understand all these things, right? And then look at Luke 24, it's not till after the resurrection. Christ is, he's meeting with the 12 after the resurrection. And they give him some food. And in verse 44, he said, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures, and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. It's not till after that Christ opens their understanding about these things. But Israel, they knew they had a hope. They didn't know it was Messiah. They're looking for him just to be their king. They didn't know it was one and the same man. But Christ is their Messiah, as their Savior. He comes and he takes that punishment for them, for their sin, so that he can offer them something else, so that he can offer them the chance to come back to God, to have their sins covered, to have their sins remitted, to bring them back into favor with God. Moses details the five courses of judgment. He says in verse 40, if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. See, if Israel recognizes their shortcomings under the law, if they recognize their failure, if they recognize their apostasy and come back to him, if they, the New Testament word is, anybody change their mind about something? They're repenting. And they're changing their, he said, that's why, you know, Matthew chapter 3 with John the Baptist shows up as the forerunner to the Messiah. And what's his message? Repent and be baptized, every one of you. Matthew chapter 3, verse 1. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John, in his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey, then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, doing what? Confessing their sins. Whose sins are they confessing? Are they coming down there and saying, you know, I stole a candy bar last week? Is that the issue here? The issue is, go to Daniel chapter 9. The issue of confessing their sins here in Matthew chapter 3 is similar to the issue here in Daniel chapter 9. When Daniel recognizes, we're in chapter 9. We've talked about this a little bit already. Verse 2. In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. Daniel understands, hey, this is supposed to take 70 years. And he can look at the calendar and say, hey, we're coming up on 70 years. Leviticus chapter 26 said, if we're going to go back into the land after being in captivity, after being under the fifth course of judgment, then what do we need to do? We need to confess our sins and turn back to him. So what does Daniel do? We see him pray down, you know, verse 3 down through verse 19. And he says in verse 20, and whilst I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mount, he's confessing the sins of the nation. And what do those sins look like? He says in verse 10, neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws which he set before us by his servants the prophets. We disobeyed the law. We broke the covenant, right? Starting with 1 and 2. Shall have no other gods before me, and not make any graven images. Israel over and over and over again repeatedly breaks those, not to mention, you know, any of the other 600 some odd commandments. They turn from him to idols. They turn from him to false gods. And that's what sends them off into captivity. That's what leads to that fifth course of judgment, or all and all the ones before it. Their apostasy, they're turning from God. And it's up to the nation, that nation, right, under this message to repent. Change your mind about that. Come, be baptized, be identified with the little flock, which is what baptism is about there. And confess your sins. Confess the sins of the nation, right? That you've turned from me, that you've walked contrary to me because you've gone off and broken my covenant. Christ then comes to fix that. And he says, Paul says in Romans chapter 15, verse 8, Romans 15, verse 8, Paul says, "Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers." When Christ came, what did he come to do? He came to confirm those promises, to make it so that they can be fulfilled, to bring Israel to the point where God is going to be able to fulfill these covenants with her. Chapter 11, "And so all Israel shall be saved." You know, look at that passage. Romans 11. Romans 11, verse 26. "And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, which shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob." See, when Christ comes as a minister of the circumcision to confirm those promises, his goal is to turn the nation from apostasy back to God, to repent. And John is not the only one who goes around preaching that, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name. He said, Christ in Matthew chapter 4, he goes out and he starts preaching that same repent and be baptized message. And verse 23 calls it, Matthew 4:23 calls it the gospel of the kingdom. So what's the gospel of the circumcision? What's the good news for the circumcision? Okay. It's that, you know what, get one other quick passage, get Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Christ dies and he ascends and he's resurrected and he's about to ascend. And what's the question that the 12 ask him in verse 6? "Wilt thou, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?" Right? What do they have? If these are the things that they need for that great nation, okay, what does Israel have here already at this point? Well, they're in the land. Now, they're not their own nation yet, so they can't control the borders, but they're in the land. And they're still a people. Right? He's not wiped them out. They are still a people in the land. What don't they have? They still have the law. They're still failing under it. Okay? The new covenant's about to come in just a second. But they're missing that kingdom. They're missing that throne. If they're going to be this nation, they need that government, that Messiah, that ruler who's going to come save them from their enemies, bring them out of captivity, bring them back into the land, reestablish them as the nation that God promised them that they would be. Christ accomplishes that. Verse 8, "But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you." At that point, right, he's going to tell them, "Hey, the Holy Ghost, my Spirit, is coming upon you." So then now, you have the land, you have the people, you're about to get the fulfillment of the new covenant, which will allow me to fulfill the Mosaic covenant. And once this is in place, I'm going to return and be your king. And once all those things are in place, the Abrahamic covenant is fulfilled. and God's plan and purpose with Israel, which began back in Genesis chapter 12, is completed. So what's the good news for the circumcision? What's the gospel of the circumcision? It's that good news regarding the fulfillment of all these covenants, right? Of all of this stuff fulfilled and wrapped up in the person of Jesus Christ. Now, Christ is going to make all of that happen. That's the good news for the circumcision. God had a plan for the circumcision. They failed on their end of it. But because of what Christ came and did for them, and what he will do for them when he returns, will bring about the fulfillment of the other pieces that they're missing. That's their good news. All Israel shall be saved. Their program will be fulfilled. It will be completed one day. Amen? Dear Lord, we thank you for this time of study, Lord. We pray that it's been edifying, Lord. We thank you for your word and for all we can learn from it, Lord. We thank you for your grace. In Jesus' name.